Good morning, everyone. welcome to this session of Think Tank. Well, Think Tank has been a group which has been holding conferences, summits, conclaves, and roundtables where CXOs, CEOs, CFOs do participate. It's current, considering the current scenario where we have to move into a digital functionality. It's been 2 months since we started going digital, and we are happy that we are connecting again. Well, we have around a lot of chartered accountants, CFAs, ICWs, CAs who do take participate in the session. A lot of MBAs are also there, IIMs. So it's absolutely a great scenario where a lot of sharing of knowledge takes place. It's been time that, like, you know, we're going to have a lot of coverage now. We have been discussing about markets, we have been discussing about IPOs, we've been discussing about various topics covering NBFCs, compliances, and today we have a great topic covering system audits and cybersecurity. Well, before we go over, I would like to, like, you know, have on Manoj share a few words, please.
Thank you. Sandeep, it's really wonderful to have an eminent expert panel out here with us sharing their practical experiences, real life examples and knowledge on various latest developments and topics of interest to all stakeholders in the corporate sector, banking, markets, deep insights. Glad to have a team of great experts here. And we wish all the panelists and the participants great sharing of experiences and knowledge and their expertise with their participants in the series of conferences, conclaves. Ajay and Yogesh, a few thoughts from you.
Manoj, can I have Mihir talk about the IPO reviews and the market trends? Mihir, I think you can proceed ahead with your thoughts on the IPO series.
Surely. So, as Manoj sir has said, and even Sandeep started with this, that the Think Tank series has been extremely instrumental in keeping all participants updated with the recent trends in the markets. And, we can see that with every passing, webinar, every passing session, we are only evolving as far as our content goes. So IPO reviews, I was told that IPO reviews is something which, many participants are extremely keen to know, because as we all know, the Nifty, the euphoria in the stock markets and, how it is raining IPOs this season. So I think this is a part of the webinars that we will be continuing. So the companies that we will be discussing today is Home First Finance Company and Stovecraft. So, disclaimer that whatever we are presenting here, these are strictly our views. These are not buy-sell calls, and, participants are expected to do their own due diligence, consult their own investment advisors before taking any investment actions. So, small houses, because they cater to the low and middle income, like lower middle income segments. Okay. Yeah. I'll just begin some issues with my network. Yeah. So the first company is Home First Finance Company. It banks itself on it being a technology-driven affordable housing finance company. And it offers most of its loans are being offered, as in more than 90% of their loans are being offered for purchase and construction of houses. And one striking feature is that it offers loans to salaried as well as self-employed people. Like, we see very few, housing finance companies actually talk about self-employed. And why this is relevant, I will, come to it later on. The average ticket size of the loan is around 1.01 million. And the loan to value on the gross loan asset is roughly close to 48-49%. Right now, it is operating in 60 districts, 11 states. It has 70 branches, and it is growing. Now, I refer to the website of the National Housing Bank because that is what governs this company. And this company is not allowed to accept public deposits. So the sources of finance for this company are long-term loans from public sector banks or other banks. Now the purpose of this IPO, okay, almost at more than 1,000 crores IPO, but most of it is offer for sale, where close to 890 crores will be paid out to the existing investors, including the promoters. And the fresh issue is only 265 crores, and they will be using it to augment their capital base and, to have their tier one capital requirements in place. Now, the business model of Home First Finance is that it targets all home buyers in the middle and low income segments. And salaried and self-employed persons are close to 98% of the gross loan assets. So there is some segment, when we visit the website of this company, we see that some portion of the loans are also being offered to NRIs and other participants. Most of the loans are for purchase of house property or construction. They also have facilities for extension and renovation of houses. So if anyone wants to undertake extension or renovation of their house, they can avail loans. And a very small portion of the business also is towards the shop loans or loans for commercial property. Now, their penetration strategy, most of the entities in the value chain of a construction business, architects, contractors, so these people actually use them to promote their services or promote their business. And then there are other loan camps, there are marketing activities as well. Very striking feature of this is that they have leveraged technology for their business activities. So they claim that all their loan processing is paperless, and they rely on a lot of data science techniques to have background checks for their loans. One point which I found very striking on the website is that they do not require any income proof for granting loans, which means the loan is fully covered by the value of the property. And this may become a problem maybe later on, because in the US we saw there was an era of ninja loans where they had no income, no job loans. So that is one thing which needs to be particular about. The average turnaround time for the loan disbursement is close to 48 hours. And this is once again on their website. Now I have some selected data. Okay, so we have revenue from operations and we have profit after tax, which has been growing consistently, except that the disbursements have actually gone down because of COVID. But I think even they are, with the pandemic situation easing, they should be back on track as far as their business goes. Credit ratings are also stable, both long term as well as short term. So A rated papers, and for short term it is even plus. So that is a stable. Not a very high rating, because the highest is AAA, but it is stable rating. Now, SWOT analysis of this company, if I have to see. So first, the strengths are the transactions are paperless. They have data science based underwriting process. So their team, relies on a lot of insights when it comes to, their customer profiling and creditworthiness of their customers. They also have a technology-driven collection system. So in the RHP, when I was referring to it, so they said that they have automated system where buyers are sent out regular reminders on their cell phones that your loans and everything is loan installments are due. Another good point about this is that their stage 3 loans, which is loans that are overdue for more than 90 days, are consistently below 1% of their loan assets. So which means that the recovery has been pretty strong, and this they have been able to maintain.
You're talking about the SWOT.
Yeah. So I discussed strengths, I discussed weaknesses. Right?
Yeah, you require to do the screen share.
Oh, sorry. Just a second. Yeah. Sorry. So I the last point I covered was around weaknesses. I hope everyone got it.
So yeah, we got it. Yeah.
Yeah. So I was discussing opportunities next. So in India, 95% of the population belongs to the lower middle income group, and that is once again a huge opportunity for such a business, because that is exactly its target segment. And next is that an article by IBEF, okay, last year had said that in the coming 10 years, the demand for real estate will mostly come from affordable loans. And that is once again an opportunity, because, you know, the government and everything is focused on, you know, providing housing facilities. So that is one area of opportunity. Now coming to threats, so the first threat is that the housing finance, okay, market itself, and especially in the affordable housing space, is an extremely, competitive market. The next weakness is that because of the NBFC crisis, okay, that has been going on in our economy for the past 2 to 3 years, the market shares of housing finance companies, okay, and the whole pie of housing loan itself has declined from 65% to now it is close to 61%. So that is, you know, one threat that, you know, if this keeps on declining further, then the business will be affected. And one more threat is that there is no income verification, as vividly visible on their website. So, you know, the possibility of the loans going bad is, you know, of course, more, because they may possibly dole out as many loans as possible. And this may become a threat in the future. So this was, you know, broadly about HFFC.
So, Mihir, I have a question. Like, do we have an idea? Like, I may have missed. What will be the asset value of this company?
So right now I am not discussing balance sheet data in the interest of time.
Okay.
Maybe we may, you know, take it up at a later point, because I need to finish this quickly. Now Stovecraft Limited. Okay. So the Stovecraft Limited, it is the largest kitchen appliance company in India, and it is operating under the brands Pigeon, Gilma, and then Black & Decker. And of course, it has almost more than 45,000 retail outlets, and it is exporting to, you know, more than 12 countries, and then it has OEM contracts with 2 more countries, so that is presence in 14 countries. Here, the product portfolio, so more than 660 products in its portfolio, 2 manufacturing facilities. And here, once again, the IPO. Almost of 400 crores of IPO, but most of it is offer for sale, and fresh issue is 95 crores, which will be utilized towards repayment of borrowings and general corporate purposes. So business model pretty straightforward. It is engaged in the manufacturing as well as retail of kitchen solutions. So that includes kitchen appliances, modular kitchen, you know, and other accessories. It primarily, it operates in 3 segments, which is value, under the Pigeon brand, and Pigeon also has an LED segment. So there is a LED line of business, and then there is Pigeon, which is primarily involved in cookware. Then there is this brand Gilma, which is the semi-premium segment. So it has modular kitchen and other accessories like chimneys and platforms and others. And then there is this premium segment, Black & Decker. So it has tied up with Black & Decker Inc., which is a global brand, and it is the retailer as well as the after sales service provider for this brand in India. And they have separate distribution network for all the above segments. Now here, if we look at the revenue from operations as well as the net profit, okay, so if we look here, the revenue growth has been very, very sporadic. In fact, in 2018, it was loss-making. Like for financial year under 2018, it was loss-making. The net profit margins also have been pretty narrow. The first half of 2021 seems to have been a good one for now. Even the credit rating, I actually got access to a publicly available document uploaded by ICRA. So the rating is BBB, which is, you know, just above, we can say, investment grade. Now SWOT analysis is, once again, the strengths is that there is distribution network and retail channel. So, you know, they have very aggressive sales kind of a strategy. They have very strong manufacturing capabilities with backward integration. Weaknesses is, again, it is not a superior kind of credit rating. It is investment grade, but, you know, if there is any rating downgrade, then that can be a problem for the company, especially when it comes to securing new loans where the cost of funds will be high. The net profit margin is low. This business got affected because of COVID, because their factories were shut down, I think for some 2 to 3 months. And I think since June, July, they started. They mentioned it in the RHP. Now, when it comes to opportunities, so there are some initiatives by the government, like the Pradhan Mantri Ujjwala Yojana, which provides free LPG connection to people. And when that is there, so, you know, there the demand for kitchen appliances will automatically be higher. And so this company can see a huge opportunity there. Next opportunity is that, you know, because it is into kitchen appliances and kitchen solutions, its demand will be very closely tied to that of real estate. Now, as we've been discussing that, you know, with the pandemic easing, the demand for real estate, you know, will soon be picking up, and then even this business can benefit out of it. Now, the threats to this company, and which I believe require some discussion, is the very first threat which they've mentioned on their RHP is that their trademark, Pigeon, is actually subject matter of litigation. So that is, you know, as far as the continuity of this Pigeon trademark goes, you know, it can be questioned. Next is that they do not have very long-term contracts with their suppliers. So, you know, there could be fluctuations in the raw material prices, and that can significantly impact the business. And another thing is that the RHP itself gives a table which says that there are many civil and criminal cases against the company, promoters, as well as directors. So, you know, there is reputational risk as far as the company goes. And, you know, we all know that whenever there are entities or whenever there are companies where the promoters are involved in criminal cases, then the stock prices seem like they tend to be depressed for very long periods of time. And that can be a huge issue for investors. So,
wonderful insights, Mayor.
Quick summary of these two IPOs. And yeah, thank you.
Wonderful insights, Mayor. Excellent SWOT analysis and insights on the business model. Now, Aditya, you asked a very, very important question. So we have a detailed analysis and a deep dive later, but your answer is very important. The size of the company as of now, as per reported numbers, is about 3,500 crores in FY20. And the company claims it's a high growth company, but it's on a very small base. So certainly you cannot compare with the HDFCs and other large company. We have done a detailed financial modeling of the company's business model and detailed deep dive. And company claims to do high growth on a very low base. And incidentally, since the question was raised, they want high price to book multiples based on a few select companies which have a long track record of performance. But one should compare this company only with the small companies. There are many small companies, Repco, Finance, GIC Housing, India Bulls Housing, which have much lower price to book multiple. But give the company its views based on its strength. And they got a large private equity player also into it. They are going to make lots of money. The private equity player got it at a deep discount to the IPO price. So good luck to them, and very good insight.